Our final speaker, Dr. Chung Ho Lin from the Center for Agroforestry here at the University of Missouri. And Dr. Lin will be talking to us about identifying value-added health-promoting compounds from waste plant materials. And so I'm very pleased to welcome Chung Ho Lin.
First, I would like to thank for inviting me to present some of my findings at this symposium. And it's exciting to see so many scientists who are sharing the common interests and share their knowledge and expertise. And I've been working with the center, try to identify some high-value health-promoting compound from the waste plant material. And the final goal is hoping we can turn some low-value material from trash into the cash that will foster the rural economic development, at the same time stabilize the rural economies. And at the same time, landowner will have some side income, you know, by utilizing those low-value products. Okay, my objective of research is very, very simple. First is turn the low-value material into high-value product. Particularly, we are targeting personal care products industry. There's a reason we're interested in personal care product industry, because as soon as you identify that compound, they can be immediately introduced to the market. You don't have to wait for 10 years for any clinical trial, and none of us honestly can afford a clinical trial. Usually, a clinical trial will take at least 10 years, and also will cost about $10 to $20 billion. I don't think we can wait. So that's the approach that can immediately bring in some revenue for the landowner. Also, we're particularly interested in elucidate the mode of action. Right now, we're particularly interested in the anti-inflammatory, antimicrobial, antifungal, skin whitening application. Also, at the same time, by working with the scientists on campus and our external collaborator and also industry, try to explore the new application. Okay, one of the project we're working on is the black walnut. There's several reasons. First of all, Missouri is the world leading producer of a black walnut with annual production of more than 25 million pounds. The Hammond's Products Company is the major leader in this production. And during that production process and processing process, there are a lot of byproducts produced, including some low-grade nut meats, shell kernels, husk, you know, collect from the orchard waste, and in the process, and also in the processing plant. We are particularly interested in two classes of a compound. One is polyphenolics, and also there's a phytosterol. So based on what we have learned, you know, by consuming the black walnut, they will help to reduce the cholesterol. Also, we found a lot of antioxidant compound and anti-inflammatory compound in those waste material. Also, some literature suggests by consuming the black walnut will help to prevent like prostate cancer and breast cancer. But there are not much the scientific study has been ever done to validate those claims. Also, another project we're working on, that's in collaboration with the scientists from Earth University and also the some producer from Ethiopia. So we want to turn those spent coffee ground into some high-value raw material for the personal care industry. So I assume 80% of you drink coffee, right? And annually more than 6 million tons of spent grounds coffee, the spent coffee ground generates worldwide. Right now, the most of the fate of this waste coffee ground goes to the, either the compost or compost or they just go in the trash. So we're thinking now, extract those high value compounds from this waste material before they'll go to the compost. So there's several kinds of compounds that we're interested in. One is the antioxidant, one is the skin whitening. Right now we have students working on fully dedicated to this project to explore the application for the personal care application, skin care application. Okay, and also by add value to this waste. Now, hopefully, we can produce some organic-based personal care product. They could be sold. I mean, in the some that like a franchise, like a Starbucks. Okay, because right now we are paying more than $10 to $20 per pound from the retail store, but the basic but the producer, they in Africa or Central America, they only got to pay less than 5 to 10 cents per pound. So by created a new industry, we were hoping the certain percentage of this product will go back to producer, okay, to help the community. Another project I'm working on is the Eastern Red Cedar. Many of you probably already familiar with this this species. Just if you include all the major states in the Midwest, there are more than 2 billion of the Eastern Red Cedar. For Missouri alone, we have a 500 million of Eastern Red Cedar. And we haven't been really get a chance to explore or utilize that. So I think they have been underutilized. And also another project I'm working on to extract some of the high value specialty chemicals from the feedstock. Our center has been heavily involved in the research on the cellulosic biofuel. But if you look at the current gas price, is cheaper than bottled water. So how can we make the cellulosic biofuel to be economically competitive? Now we've been thinking all different approach, but one approach is to make that become the feasible and economically competitive is to extract those high value chemical and use that revenue to compensate the production of the fuel. Okay, if you just try to use the cellulosic biofuel, it's not going to be compatible. So we developed the idea of biorefinery. We're hoping one day we can generate enough revenue from this special chemical. Okay, then eventually we can give those a fuel for free. That's our dream. Okay. And like Dr. Sumner said, before the metabolomics platform were available, my lab has been following the traditional approach to isolate those health-promoting biochemical. As he suggested and mentioned, this is very time-consuming, okay, and labor-intensive. So in my lab, I would say we have been spent almost more than 6 years using the traditional way to isolate, extract, fractionate, using the bioacid guide purification scheme to isolate that bioactive compounds that were interested. Usually, just isolate and characterize one simple compound, usually at least take 1.5 years. Okay. This very time consuming and very expensive process. And so we've been working on for almost six years. But about 3 years ago, we decided to embrace the modern technology, the new computation power, and all the advanced platform has been developed so far. Okay. And right now, about 3 years ago, we decided to partner with the KU high throughput screening facility. Now, in that process, they can help us speed up the screening process. Traditionally, we have to do everything manually, but their facility, they use a robot to do the high throughput screening. And for every screening, all they need is 10 nanoliter of sample. So every week, using the robot, they can process 80,000 bioassay, including anti-tumor, anti-melanoma, anti-fungal, anti-inflammatory. So when we're sleeping, they're working for us, okay? So, and also by incorporating some of the modern metabolomic global metabolite profiling approach, so that allow us to characterize the different kinds of compound in those in our extract. So we've been working with the Scripp Research Institute at San Diego, and then we still have to rely on a lot of external collaborator to acquire a lot of high resolution data. And fortunately, and Dr. Sumner and his team brought a lot of fancy toys and a lot of expertise to MU campus last year. I think for me, it was the right timing. By working with their team, they really speed up our process and take our research completely to another level. So I feel very fortunate to have their support. They've been very generous to offer all the training support and access to these fancy toys. Okay, so what we've been doing, once we capture this fingerprint, I will make a simple language, fingerprint. Okay, there's a full scan of this the fingerprint. We submit this to the server at the Scripp Research Institute. This server is equipped with 1400 CPU to process this information. Okay, and they help us to run the deconvolution and also help us to align the peak and also to help us to do the peak alignment and also annotation that allow us to identify all the possible health promoting compounds in our extract from the waste material. Okay, this kind of give you one example, just one single injection that allows us to identify more than 200 health-promoting compound identified either in the coffee or in the black walnuts. And based on this information, we can identify what will be the possible application for skincare. So this will at least give you the example of some of the antioxidant profile among the different variety of the black walnuts. Okay, those so based on the when we compare different variety, this one particular variety, mystery, that showed a much higher antioxidant activity than the other varieties. And also this is the only variety, okay, the extract that showed a high antimicrobial activity against staph aureus. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with the staph aureus, but probably you already learned, have probably already heard in the news, you know, this is considered as the drug resistant, okay, the pathogen, okay. Usually there's no antibiotic available that can kill this drug resistant pathogen, the considered gram positive. So we after we identify this fraction, we conduct the refined purification, and we just send our purified compound to the Dr. Summers lab for the structure characterization. Also, at the same time, we have isolated several antimicrobial diterminal from the berries of the eastern red cedar. We're particularly interested in the berries. There's a reason, because eventually we want to treat the eastern red cedar as a crop, because the berries are the renewable component, so we can collect this material on annual basis without cutting down the tree, right? They could be the sustainable source of this bioactive chemical. And do the variety of the assay, we realize the bioactive compound, the diterpenol tautural, is particularly active against the MRSA. Okay, this is MIC, the lower is better. So that activity is better than any other antibiotics available on the market, available right now. Okay. So, and this compound has been already been formulated into the several personal care products by Johnson & Johnson for acne treatment. So they give you this kind of a comparison. There's the acne before, there's 42 days after the treatment, okay? And also this compound has been also incorporated into the toothpaste to prevent the gum disease. Also have been incorporated the chewing gum and supplied to the soldier in the battlefield, so they can help them to protect their gum, to prevent the gum disease. Okay. And because of this unique mode of action, we are very interested how that works, why that works so well. So we use the process called the mutagenesis, because we know this MRSA is sensitive to our compounds, right? So we use the chemical to do the random mutation. We're hoping if the target got mutated, okay, they will give that strain a resistance. So fortunately, we got through the several trial and error. Fortunately, we got the resistant mutant. So right now we have sensitive parents and also resistant mutant, right? And at the same time, we speculate that target was mutated through this process. Okay. Right now we have two strains: sensitive parent and resistant mutant. Then we send both strains for the complete genome sequencing. Then we compare where is it mutated, and we're hoping that will be the target. So right now we are already, by comparing the complete genome sequence, we already identified the 20 potential target. Okay, and by that information we learn one of compound, the diterpenol, they inhibit the cell division of the staph aureus, okay, by inhibiting the FTAZ polymerization, okay. In order to visualize that effect, we label the FTAZ by green fluorescent protein. Let me explain a little bit about the FTAZ. FTAZ basically is a small protein, usually it is swimming around, you know, inside the MRSA, okay, inside the cell. So when the cell is ready to start the division, they will start to polymerize and develop a FTAZ ring and concentrate in the middle of the cell before initiate the cell division, okay? But when this process was inhibited, okay, when this process inhibited, they never get a chance to form that ring. So basically, this FTAZ just still swimming everywhere. They never get a chance to aggregate in the center of the cell. In other words, they will never be able to initiate the cell division. What happened, what's the outcome of that? If they cannot initiate cell division and the cell still growing, eventually erupt. So we believe that's the major mode of action. At the same time, we're conducting the molecular, the docking, try to identify where is the target. I think that information is going to be helpful for a lot of pharmaceutical company to design the next generation of antibody to treat the drug-resistant human pathogen. At the same time, we identify several active fractions. They will inhibit the biosynthesis of melanin. Okay, here you can see there's the control and there's a bioactive fraction. Why the melanin inhibition is important for the skincare products? You will inhibit the development, the pigment, right? Like liver spot, right? And the pigment. And we believe that's a great commercial application for the skin whitening products, especially for Asia. I know people living in this country, they like to get a suntan. But most of the Asian girls, they want to look as white as it can be, okay? So that's a huge potential, I mean, for the Asian market, particularly in the China, Korea, Japan, Taiwan. They like to look almost like a pale, okay? Okay, so And when we react some of the bioactive compound with the melanoma cell, we also realize, okay, we also realize you will kill the melanoma cell. Okay, this showed some photo, and this give you better picture, okay? We label this melanoma cell with a fluorescent signal. So as you can see, those melanoma cells, they look perfect in the control, but that's what happened 10 minutes after we apply and treat it with our bioactive diterbenol. And other than this waste material, our center has been promoting the collaboration with other international scientists. So we also work on different plant material like rice or some native plant. This is one of the plant that's a Photolacca labinia that's been native in the Pakistan in the Himalaya region. That plant has been long history used as a female Viagra, okay? So that for hundreds of years, okay? For hundreds of years. And we have isolated several allelopathic, okay, compounds and also anti-inflammatory compounds from this plant. At the same time, we want to provide some scientific evidence about this estrogenic, efficacy. So we use a molecular assay, and based on this result, we realize the compound in this extract from this plant will target the estrogenic receptor and activate the estrogenic activity. Okay. And also, how many?
You can wrap it up in a minute or two, and then we're
going to
have...
Okay, 2 minutes, okay. Also, our center has been working with the cell process. in the Pennsylvania try to develop the environmentally friendly protocol to extract this bioactive chemical. Okay, and we've been using the carbon dioxide supercritical extractions protocol to extract or fractionate those bioactive compound. Because if you use a traditional solvent extraction system, it's too expensive. Now it's not going to be economically viable. But in this system, we pressurize the carbon dioxide as a solvent to extract the chemical and fractionate. By manipulating the temperature and pressure, we can even do the fractionation. So in this case, there's no solvent residue in your final products, and the carbon dioxide can be recycled and reused over and over again. It's a very cheap process. And we believe now in the long run, that's the only approach to provide enough material and cheap material now to create the market. I probably will not go into too much detail, but for the feedstock, okay, biofuel feedstock, there are a lot of high-value anti-inflammatory chemical and also the strong antioxidant. They are abundant, but usually they are poor. They have poor solubility, and usually they are not stable when you want to formulate into the personal care products. So by using a lot of enzymatic process, we can make it into more stable and can be more active and can be easily formulated into the personal care products. So we've been utilizing several enzymatic systems to convert some of the abundant precursor into the high-value raw material. Okay, that can be easily formulated into the personal care products. Our center recently has been put a team together to design the continuous flow multi-enzyme bioreactor system. Okay, using that system, we can feed those precursor and collect those high-value byproduct. This system consists of two major components. One is an engineered recombinant enzyme with a linker. Okay. And also, there's another critical component is the platform developed by 3D printing, made of the polypropylene. Okay, as you can see, there are a lot of fine pores, you know, inside of this we call that cartridge, because of the high specificity between the linker and the functionalized group on the servers. We eliminate the requirement of enzyme purification and at the same time allow us to immobilize multiple class of enzyme on the one single cartridge. And one thing nice about this system, you know, we can keep using that over and over again. Because usually, traditionally, the enzyme has a very short half-life. By immobilizing this platform, the prototype has been last for 6 months already, still going. And the one thing nice about this technology, we can also regenerate the process. If we start to see the enzyme activity start to decrease, we can regenerate this platform and attach a new batch to the recombinant enzyme on the servers. So we've been feeding the precursor, the substrate, you know, through this continuous flow system, keep it recirculating, okay? That is one of our result. This is the time, and this is the product. It still keep growing, okay? Well, we plan on utilize this system to convert some of the low-value raw material into high-value product that can be immediately formulated into the personal care product, okay? So we believe some of the compound we identify from this project can be immediately, introduced for personal care products industry for anti-inflammatory application, antimicrobial, and also for skin whitening products. Okay, they can be formulated into a wide variety of the personal care products, including shampoo, chewing gum, lotion, cream, spray, shaving cream, ornament, wound dressing, okay, bandage, and hand sanitizer and hydrogel. Okay, that's our goal. Okay, and I would like to thank all my collaborators, the funding through our center, and also collaborator at Life Science Center, and also particularly Dr. Sumner and his team at the MU Metabolomic Center. Very good.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Lin, and thank you everyone for being here. We're running a little bit behind schedule, but we're going to take a few minutes to have some question and answers. I think what we'll do is we'll have a question and answer session for all of the previous presentations of this session. So for Dr. Sumner and Dr. Fahey and Dr. Lin. But before we do that, I just want to make a few announcements. Just so you know that lunch is available, food is available up in the upper atrium where our exhibitors, you can access that through the stairs or through the elevator. We have some food items there. If you need other options, just ask one of the Center for Agroforestry volunteers for directions over to the Student Center, but we do have food and drinks available for you up in the atrium. Let's take a bit of time to keep a question and answer session going for those who did have questions for our previous speakers. So if there are any questions for any of the previous sessions, we'll take some time. And you can also move on to the atrium when you're ready. So thank you. Yes, here. Let's start here. Excuse me. Yes,
please, go ahead.
I had a question for Dr. Lin. I noticed in your slide on the health benefits of the black walnut, you had a list of various cultivars and varieties of black walnuts. And I was just wondering, did you look at any of the native black walnuts also? And if so, how did they compare to the cultivars?
We haven't got a chance to compare the native black walnuts yet. So right now we're trying, now at this point, we are trying to compare the chemical profile between the black walnut and Persian walnut in California. We haven't get a chance to compare to some of the variety from the local, the native variety.
Great, thank you.
Hello, yes?
Yes, please, go ahead.
I just wanted to comment on Dr. Fahey's presentation on Moringa. In your opening statement, you said that in Missouri, we may not be able to grow Moringa. I work with small farmers in the state of Missouri. Missouri is an amazing state. Here, we have a lot of crop diversity, one of the most diverse states in the United States. And you may be surprised to know that we do grow Moringa in Missouri. I work with 400 small farmers in the state, and we have about 25 Hmong farmers located in the southwest corner of the state, and they do grow Moringa as an annual crop, and they harvest the leaf, and they have a good market in Kansas City area. So they make pretty good money growing Moringa as an annual crop.
I must bow to you and apologize. First of all, I was not disrespecting the state of Missouri at all. I was commenting on the fact that it is a tropical crop, and I come from Maryland, where we sometimes have hard freezes and hard winters, as I know you do here. And for years, I tried to grow it in Maryland, and it gets killed off by the winter freezes. It can certainly be grown, and in Maryland we are growing it in hoop houses, in hot houses, where you preserve root temperature over the cold months. So I'm surprised to hear that. I'm delighted, and I'd like to learn more about that. But it is a crop which, okay, Let me back off then and say 1 out of 10 years, your crop is probably going to hit the skids if there's a hard freeze, because that's sort of the experience that others have had with it. And it's grown in Taiwan, for example, and I know that they have to be a little bit more careful about protecting it there. So had nothing to do with Missouri, just your climate zone. But
that is the reason they grow it as an annual crop.
Yes, okay. So it's grown, we've, in the deep tropics.
Outside in the field.
What's
that? Hoop house, not high tunnel. Outside in the field.
Okay. Well, that's delightful to hear.
Thanks.
Yes, please, in the back here.
Hi. So I work with small farmers over in Kenya and Jordan, Afghanistan, and Cambodia, so all over the world with regenerative agriculture and permaculture and nutrition. And I wanted to ask Dr. Fahey, and this is interesting because moringa is a fast-growing plant, so I know a lot about it. And that's probably why they're maybe so successful here as an annual crop for the moringa, because it is a fast-growing plant. So if they've got 6 months. Oh, okay. Hello. Can you hear now? Okay. So moringa is a fast-growing plant. So in 6 months, it can be pretty prolific. So maybe that's the reason why they can do the annual crop. For Dr. Fahey, I know over in Kenya, and I wanted to ask you, you probably are aware of this, and with your clinical studies, they have been using moringa besides as a nutritional supplement and for animals, because this is what we do. But they also have discovered that it's for HIV patients, the T4 cell, that it actually boosts the immune system of HIV patients over in Kenya. And they've been doing, Westerners have been doing extensive studies over there with the T4 cell. And I wanted to ask, have you come across that with any other types of clinical studies? Are you aware of?
So yes, and I'd like to go back to your first comment also, but so yes, there is at least one study on clinicaltrials.gov, which is talking about its use in HIV. My first knowledge that it's been used traditionally, well, I guess we can't talk about traditionally beyond 1983 or so, right? But early on, it was used against HIV. At this Ghana Moringa conference, there were physicians, and in fact, I remember a very poignant story, a physician who had someone who had HIV AIDS wasting and essentially wasn't able to work and was in sort of very terminal stages and started supplementing his diet with Moringa regularly and wound up going back to work, putting on weight, going back to work. His counts went way back down. So the anecdotes absolutely support that. Again, we can't go back to traditional medicine over centuries because fortunately HIV hasn't been around that long. But I am aware that people are looking at it as an antiviral and against HIV. I think I mentioned there was, it wasn't HIV, but there was another antiviral study in vitro by team led by Guevara, G-U-E-V-E-R-A, and it was published in 1999. And so I think we're going to find that there is substantial antiviral activity to it. And I'm delighted to hear that this critical work is going on. I just want to go back to your comment about it's growing in Missouri and Kansas and everywhere else. If you grow it as an annual crop, one of the problems, though, is of course, getting the seed and generating seed. The seeds are big. It's not like teff or something where the seeds are tiny. Moringa seeds are big honking things the size of my thumb. And so getting the volume of seed to plant it out annually is difficult. And you're dependent upon someone growing it in the tropics because you can't grow it to seed in 1 year here. I mean, if you're lucky and you goose it through a couple of winters, you may be able to collect some seed. So with Mark Olson, whom I mentioned, who is a product of Missouri education, We have this Moringa Germplasm Center on the in Jalisco State in Mexico. And what we've done, and Mark gets the 99.9% of the credit for this, is during his thesis work at the university here in St. Louis, he went all over the world and collected Moringa, all of the 13, well, I think he got 12 of the 13 genera of the Moringa genus, including a lot of different Moringa oleifera. And that's being grown out, and we're doing comparisons, interspecies and intervariety comparisons, you know, in the same site, only one site at the moment. Same site, same weather, same conditions, et cetera. And looking at protein content, vitamins, because it's been hyped for its vitamin C and so on and so forth.
Potassium, loaded with potassium.
Right, all of the, you've seen those metrics that were replicated, by the way, from something that was generated at Trees for Life in Wichita about 15 or 20 years ago. So that's all being done, and the comparisons are interesting. And I bring it up because if you're buying seed, the seed, a lot of seed came from a variety called PKM1 that was produced by plant breeders in Tamil Nadu in India many years ago, and it was bred for uniformity and stand height and seed yield and things like that. But we're trying to get some comparisons of these popular cultivated varieties or cultivars for their protein level and vitamin levels, et cetera. Mark has gone to South Asia, went last year, and is going back this summer. And we're trying to get other sites of Moringa-friendly people in their native, in its native areas.
Well, like one in Kenya, I've got, because yeah. I'm going back in June, I have an ongoing project there in Kenya, in its dry land, which I'm very interested in.
Except,
be very open to it. It's a small community. We've got 450 farmers over.
Well, we'll
people working together.
We'll have to connect you. I should just mention, in terms of annual growth, in the Congo about 8 or 10 years ago, we had a medical student from Hopkins who went and tried to set up an HIV clinical trial. They didn't have an institutional review board, an ethics board, so the trial never got started. But there are areas, for example, in Congo and in temperate zones where people coppice Moringa. They grow it very dense planted, cut it off after 4 to 6 weeks, and treat it essentially as a veg crop, as a leafy vegetable. And it will regrow and regrow and regrow until you ultimately, of course, have to replant, sort of like retuning sugarcane or something.
It's for against deforestation. So it's coppicing is great for some of those plants and trees. And it's prolific.
Thank you. We've been going too long, probably.
Sorry.
So
yeah, thank you very much. And I hope maybe you can connect during the break. And please, our guests and participants, please, most of our speakers will be available during the breaks to have some supplemental conversations. I think in the interest of time, we'll stop here. Again, we do have food, lunch items up in the atrium. We'll start back here again at 2 o'clock with a presentation on international partnerships for medicinal plant conservation and a panel discussion with growers and entrepreneurs. Please visit our exhibitors in the upper atrium. Again, we start here again at 2 o'clock. And thank you to all of our sponsors, Mountain Rose Herbs, United Plant Savers, the Mizzou Botanic Garden, Forest Keeling Nurseries, The Carbon Underground, Missouri Wildflowers Nursery, Finca Luna Nueva, Gaia Herbs, Herb Farm, the American Herbal Products Association, and Grow Native Project here in Missouri. Thank you very much. See you at 2 o'clock.